Horrific fates aren't just left for the big screen horror, as these characters would tell you. I'm Tilly from What Culture Horror, and these are the 8 TV horror fates worse than death. 8. Judith's Broken Psyche, Slasher. Slasher is a Canadian horror anthology series produced for Netflix, with each story focusing on a different group of would-be victims and a serial killer looking to hack and slash them to pieces. Standard stuff. Season 2 of the series, Guilty Party, follows the story of a group of camp counselors killing one of their friends and returning to the scene of the crime that winter, only to find that the body has been discovered and their secret is out. They are forced into staying at a resort, only for a masked killer that has discovered the secret to begin picking off each one of them through particularly gruesome means. The true killer is one of the resort's residents, a woman named Judith Berry. Haunted by the memory of her son, who was framed for the original murder and then later hanged in jail, Judith is mentally unstable and clearly unable to find a way of moving on from what happened to her son, even after she begins her murderous rampage. The final scene of the season shows Judith stalking the last two survivors of her murder spree before turning to have a conversation with her son, showcasing that she is still unable to satisfy her bloodlust and will continue to suffer from this trauma for the rest of her life. It's ironic that in a series that has people being burned alive, split apart, and smashed in the head with a boulder, it's the killer who gets to freely walk away that is ultimately left with one of the worst fates of all. 7. Hyun-soo Condemned to His Monstrous Form, Sweet Home. Based off the famous Naver webtoon of the same name, Sweet Home is a post-apocalyptic South Korean series that follows a group of humans attempting to survive in a building complex against an infection that turns people into monsters. Song Kang plays the show's main protagonist, Hyun-soo, a high school student who embodies everything audiences would expect to see from a leading hero. However, throughout the series, Hyun-soo's life is increasingly made to be a living hell through the nightmarish scenarios he and his fellow survivors are thrown into. It is also revealed that he is actually infected as well, transforming between human and monster form, usually when distressed, and causing distrust between his fellow survivors as the show goes on. The first season ends with Hyun-soo recovering in an armored van escort. At first, he is led to think that he is safe in the company of his human ally and friend, Sang-wook. However, things close with the revelation that it is actually the monster Jung-Wi-myung taking his form, and the show's hero is being carted off once again in the monster's possession, practically confirming Hyun-soo's human days are at an end. 6. Annie's Wicked Delusions Continue, Castle Rock. Castle Rock was a horror anthology series developed for streaming on Hulu, and revolved around the Stephen King universe of characters and his fictional setting of Castle Rock in Maine. One of the most legendary characters the author has created is Misery's Annie Wilkes, portrayed in the show by Lizzie Kaplan. The show deviates slightly by presenting Annie as a mentally ill nurse who is stuck in Castle Rock. Though what hasn't changed from the source material is her absolute obsession with the author Paul Sheldon. Annie is an unstable individual, to say the least, and the full effects of the second season's events really do a great job of hammering this point home to the audience. In the final episode of the season, Annie mistakenly thinks that her friend Joy is possessed by a cultist and goes out of her way to drown the woman in the lake. Realizing her mistake, she attempts to resuscitate her friend, and is first shown to be apparently successful in doing so. It is only when the next scene rolls around and the two friends are waiting in line for a book signing with Paul Sheldon that the true extent of Annie's mental damage is shown, with the revelation that she is still in the midst of hallucinating her friend's recovery and is doomed to continue living within her own delusions for good. 5. Mike Breaks Realities, Channel Zero. Portrayed by Paul Schneider, Mike Painter is the main protagonist of the first season of Channel Zero, Nick Antosca's horror anthology series on Sci-Fi. The first season of the show, Candle Cove, revolves around child psychologist Mike returning to his hometown 30 years after an unknown serial killer murdered 5 children, with his younger brother being among the victims. The name of this season comes from a very creepy television show Mike claims to have watched as a child that features strange puppet pirates before being hooked off the air mysteriously around the same time as the murders. The season is filled with strange twists and turns, as well as a plethora of harrowing scenes that Mike is forced to soldier through, ranging from discovering the decomposed body of his younger brother, which he then has to burn, to being stabbed in the arm and having to rip out an ingrowing tooth. Nice. The first season of the show ends with Mike forced to delay the supernatural entity that is his younger brother with a game of cards they used to play as children, and ultimately is forced to accept his evil twin with all of his horrors while also losing a part of himself in the younger sibling's dream world. 4. Creature's Eternal Wait for Love, Penny Dreadful. Out of all of the gothic horrors and stories reimagined for Penny Dreadful, few characters made the same level of impact as Frankenstein's creature. In the show, the creature is the remains of what was once a mortal man that was brought back to life thanks to the scientific capabilities of Victor Frankenstein. Known as the scientist's firstborn, Creature spends most of the first 3 seasons of the show soldiering through and experiencing the absolute worst of humanity's cruelty, when all he really wants is to have someone to share love with. And while the theme can be a little bit on the nose at times, it's one of the best examples of the real-world source material being conveyed on the small screen. The creature does eventually manage to turn his goal into a reality, though, through his son, Jack. He scrambles his way to London, where he instantly bonds with his son. However, when Jack is finally able to see his father, he is appalled at the sight and rejects him before popping his clogs. It's truly a tough scene to watch in its own right, but the 3rd season of the show still finds the time to nestle in a sequence of the creature burying his son's corpse in the river, condemned to live out the rest of his days with no one to love or feel love from. Sheesh! 3. Montrose Doesn't Say Goodbye, Lovecraft Country. Montrose Freeman is one of Lovecraft Country's main characters, introduced as being the father to the missing man Atticus. And right from the off, Michael Kenneth Williams' character is shown to be someone that is just asking for fate and karma to bite them on the ass. Abused by his father as a child, Montrose is both a confrontational drunk and a layered figure shrouded in secrets. In the final episode of the 1st season, in what is one of his more serious moments of growth, Montrose is trying to stop Atticus from using the blood tie in Hannah's spell, an act that he knows will kill his son. Tick first lies to him, explaining that he's wrong about his self-sacrifice, but Montrose is knocked unconscious as his son is killed. In one of the most powerful moments of the show's 1st season, Montrose is shown coming back round and calling out for his son, unaware that he's been sacrificed. Parents outliving their children is one of the most harrowing things to present on screen, and Atticus's final letter to his dad is of little comfort to the man who has to go on living without him. 2. Lady Viola's Eternal Wonders, The Haunting of Bly Manor. Lady Viola Willoughby was introduced as the elder of the 2 sisters who owned Bly Manor, and a character whose enduring trait is a seriously extreme level of stubbornness shown throughout her timeline. Viola gives birth to a girl after marrying a dashing man, but is then shown contracting the plague with no hope of recovery. Her stubbornness continues to defy the doctor's diagnosis, and she soldiers through, albeit in excruciating amounts of pain. She is forced to remain locked in her bedroom away from her child and listens to her sister and husband getting inappropriately close. She becomes more and more twisted and resentful over the years, turning into something much more nasty whilst living solely in isolation. I think we all know a bit about how that feels at the moment. Eager to get her hands on the manor, Viola is suffocated in her sleep one night by her sister, Perdita. Her spirit is left locked in a trunk, and she eventually gets her revenge by killing Perdita as she's attempting to steal her jewellery and fine clothes. Viola's spirit and trunk is then tossed into Bly's lake by her widower, but she continues to live on, waking every night, climbing out of the lake, wandering the grounds and claiming the souls of anyone present in the manor, until a new Lady of the Manor can be found. 1. Richard is doomed to die again, and again, and again, and again, and again. American Horror Story. Richard was introduced to the American Horror Story anthology first in Hotel as a heinous serial killer that attended the Devil's Night Soiree. However, it wasn't until the 1984 storyline that audiences really got a full glimpse of his grotesque personality, and in turn, gruesome demise. A Satanist, serial killer, and rapist, Richard Ramirez is led to Camp Redwood by Satan himself after trying and failing to kill Brooke. He arrives at the camp and practically becomes the resident serial killer for the characters to contend with, before having his head impaled via a tree branch courtesy of Richter. Richard then gets a taste of the immortal life and is resurrected by Satan to carry on in his killing, returning to Camp Redwood. Things reach a climax when the Satanist serial killer is tricked by Mortana and set upon by all the ghosts of Camp Redwood, who take turns plunging their weapons and carving up his body. His satanic blessing continues to bring Richard back from the dead. However, the ghosts assure him that they're prepared to continue killing for all eternity, and his fate remains a constant cycle of being killed, coming back to life, only to continue being killed over and over again. And that's our list. What fates in TV horror shows made you grimace? Let us know down in the comments section below. If you enjoyed the video, don't forget to like and subscribe, and swing on by our channel again if you want to catch more creepy content. I've been Tilly, and this has been What Culture. Thank you so much for watching, and make sure to keep on looking after yourselves. Until next time.